then 5 minutes ago, and then 0 hour, and all hell lets loose. There's our barrage, the Germans' barrage, and over the top we go. As soon as you get over the top, fear has left you, and it's terror. You don't, look, you see. You don't hear, you listen. Your nose is filled with fumes and death. You taste the top of your mouth. You're a weapon, and you are one. Hunter, you're back to the jungle. The veneer of civilization has dropped away.
Perhaps for many of us, the great battles of the First World War appear as described here, a cacophony of noise and smells and death. Couple these with the chilling stories of veterans, with that of the potent post-1960s pacifist historiography, it is hard to believe that there was ever order and just disorder. The Battle of the Somme marked a period of maturation undergone by the British Army that saw it develop into a more dominant force on the Western Front. The battle was led by an Anglo-French coalition and is described by William Philpott as the biggest coalition offensive yet seen. The French army, who considered its contribution on the 1st of July as a success, was more advanced in their tactical methods after their own harsh schooling in 1915. In this presentation, I will seek to establish the significant junctures in the application and development of the British Army's operational art throughout the battle and to draw a comparison between its adolescent command of pre-July 1916 to that of its maturer self by the 18th of November. Whilst the art of war is a concept that has lasted for more than a millennia, Ronald Sprang argues that operational art, a concept termed in 1930s Russia, can trace its theoretical beginnings to Napoleon's six-month campaign in 1812. He says the concept provides the bridge between tactical and strategic objectives. Interestingly, United States Brigadier General Justin Kelly and Dr. Michael Brennan argue that operational art supplants the traditional role of civilian leadership. The article this summary is taken from goes on to point out fundamental differences between a craft, or a science, and art, stating art holds value dependent on individual creativity and merit. Further, the artist is just as renowned as the pieces he or she creates. We don't just speak of David, but Michelangelo's David, or Van Gogh's Starry Night. Operational art may have been a concept defined in a post-First World War era, yet from these modern interpretations one can already glimpse some of the potential problems with merging individual creativity and merit with the biggest battle the world had ever known. This presentation will analyse the various forms of operational artistry of the British Army during this period, taking a chronological structural approach from the battle's late planning stages in June 1916 through to its end in mid-November. In his report of the battle, dated the 23rd of December 1916, Haig states that a very large proportion of the officers and men under my command were still far from being fully trained. In many ways, supporting this is the argument of Beckett, Bowman and Connolly, who described the situation of early 1916. All of a sudden, the adolescent British Army was expected to carry the weight of the offensive while lacking the necessary skills at all levels to perform it. What those necessary skills were can be determined by looking forward to what worked later, in the battle and in the war as a whole, themes that will be addressed during this presentation. But it can also be argued that Haig's refusal to adopt the suggestions made by Kitchener, Robertson, Rawlinson and Montgomery of a step-by-step approach in place of his more aggressively optimistic objectives reflects more of Haig's regular inability to listen to his generals and advisers and his desire to shoot the moon at seemingly every opportunity than of an army rushed into battle by simply uncontrollable external pressures. Haig ignored them and overreached, squandering the fighting power of his army, destroying much of its impetus and making it far less dangerous to the Germans than it otherwise could have been. At this angle, the army's adolescence manifests itself in an individual rather than, say, the body of inexperienced Kitchener's army recruits. Yet, it is too simple to suggest that it was only Haig's stubbornness that denied the British Army its quick victory in July. One could argue that, although the bite-and-hold approach offered much success later in the battle and the war, if it were not for the progress of the other factors, such as the advances of the artillery, technological and human, its successes on the 1st of July may not have been as great as one might have thought. And whilst Haig's generals may have believed Haig was overreaching in his aims, he was still their commander-in-chief after all, and evidence suggests that Rawlinson had not fully divorced himself from his own operational art and prejudices and prepare as per his boss's plans. His inability to react to the successes of his 4th Army in the south of the front in the opening days has drawn much criticism in historiography. Pryor and Wilson suggest that his cautious battle plans didn't facilitate any line breakthroughs or extensive land gains. By his earlier emphasis on consolidating objectives captured, and by his caution in the timing in the second phase advance, Rawlinson had ensured that there would be no force available to exploit his success on this part of the front. In his defence, Bowman, Becken and Connolly state that from the early stages of planning, Rawlinson's strategy was not about breakthrough, rather it was a mission to gain ground with the intention of killing Germans in large numbers. The three historians believe that the idea was sensible but lacked detail, in particular, artillery-infantry cooperation. The historians also suggest that after his varying degrees of success in 1915, Rawlinson had been made largely dependent on Haig as a patron, and that in the months leading up to the battle, the commander-in-chief had veered between seeing it as a wearing-out battle and a decisive offensive. Once again, the blame ball is back in Haig's court, where it seems reasonable to suggest that the CNC's indecisiveness in this period would have been incredibly confusing for the rest of high command, all the way down to commanders at divisional level, who would have likely struggled to implement their own operational artistry to complement the shaky grand plan of the offensive. It is worth noting, however, that General Allenby appeared to comfortably navigate through Haig's confusing changes of heart and lack of clarity. In 1917, Chief Intelligence Officer at GHQ, John Charteris, wrote in his diary, "Allenby shares one peculiarity with Douglas Haig. He cannot explain verbally with any lucidity at all what his plans are. Douglas Haig hardly ever finishes a sentence, and Allenby's sentences, although finished, do not really convey exactly what he means. Yet they understand one another perfectly. But as each of their particular staffs only understands their immediate superior, a good deal of explanation of details has to be gone into afterwards and cleared up." Couple that with Haig's dislike for Allenby. By the 1st of July, the three men at the top of the Somme food chain had provided a shaking canvas upon which the rest of the British Army had the intricate task of painting by numbers. As we move into the opening days of the battle, it is worth noting a point that is often neglected in British historiography of the battle while simultaneously offering the apologetic statement, "The French were there too." Taking a closer look at the Anglo-French junction in the south, Colonel Fairfax, commander of 17th Battalion King's Liverpool Regiment, and Commandant Le Petit of the 153RI were shaking hands within the hour. Philpott states not only had they stayed together, but they had advanced with speed and determination, their fired-up men sweeping the remnants of the battered enemy before them. The successful display of tactical art in this on-the-ground cooperation and a British trusting of superior French know-how did not seem to extend to the operational art of its higher command. During the months of preparation, no adequate mechanism was created for ensuring coordination of the Anglo-French forces, which meant that both armies carried out their own planning and preparatory work in almost total isolation. Even in the rare occurrences when the commanders spoke, Haig often defied Joffe. Elizabeth Greenhalg suggests that the commanders of the BEF rarely acted on France's urgings, particularly in tactical matters, where they might have done a deal of good. She points out that on the 3rd of June, whilst a note from the Grand Quartier General was passed around, stating that assault waves composed of men shoulder to shoulder were to be absolutely forbidden. At the same time, General Rawlinson's HQ were planning to send dense formations to storm the enemy trenches. By the end of July, whilst under pressure from the British Parliament to scale down the Somme offensive, Haig was under equal pressure from Joffe to persevere. He decided to continue, which could be argued as a positive move in the direction of Anglo-French cooperation. Paul Harris and Sanders Marble disagree, however, and suggest that Haig normally complied with French demands only when it suited him, or he thought it absolutely necessary to do so. He continued the attack on the Somme mainly because he believed he could break through. J.P. Harris goes as far to say that Haig prided himself on his ability to resist Joffe's demands. In his own dispatches, Haig only ever seems to mention coming to a decision on matters with Joffe and neglects to reference the volatile rocky road that led to it. As previously analogised, all this perhaps has more to do with the canvas than the painting. Yet without a steady canvas and a steady hand, the entire piece would be greatly affected. On the 14th of July, some things went right. But in these successes, is there evidence of a genuine improvement in operational art? Although the overall failure of the British Army's command to listen to their French counterpart was certainly problematic on the 1st of July, its successes on the 14th of July were in spite of a proposed strategy from Joffre and fears expressed by the French. The day was dubbed a British success and marked the beginning of a change in British operational art. Improvements with regard to artillery facilitated the capture of positions. Although fewer guns were used compared to July the 1st, their fire was more concentrated, and the effect of the three-day bombardment was some five times more intensive. A bombardment of increased intensity commenced 5 minutes before the infantry attack, which aided them in the race to the parapet, a race which proved fatally crucial on the 1st of July. Pryor and Wilson attribute the cause of this significant achievement to the artillery and suggest how the evidence leaves this matter in no doubt. Rawlinson later expressed how there was no doubt that the successes of the enterprise must be attributed in very large measure to the accuracy and volume of the artillery bombardment. So what had improved? Much of the artillery success can be placed on the implementation of the creeping barrage. On July the 1st, Rawlinson's grand plan relied very heavily on the accurate bombardment of enemy lines at exact times, thereby neglecting the space between German trenches and the possibility, and later absolute reality, that the attacking waves were not where they were supposed to be according to the predetermined timings. It is worth highlighting a point made by Sanders Marble, however, that one of the great problems of the creeping barrage was that it had to adhere to a timetable. This meant that a local delay could ripple through an entire attack. Observation and communication were fundamental areas that needed improvement. Yet the primitive creeping barrages on July the 14th helped unify the infantry and artillery operations and allow for certain on-the-spot amendments to the original plans by commanders. On July the 16th, a very excited GHQ released a memo stating, "One of the outstanding artillery lessons of the recent fighting has been the great assistance afforded by a well-directed field artillery barrage maintained close in front of the advancing infantry. It is beyond dispute that on several occasions where the field artillery has been a considerable lift, that is to say, has outstripped the infantry advance, the enemy has been able to man his parapets with rifles and machine guns. It is therefore of first importance in all cases. The field artillery barrage should not uncover the first objective until the infantry are close up to it, even within 50 or 60 yards. Greenhalgh ponders the understatement of the French artillery support provided before and during the fighting, suggesting that it played a more crucial part in that success than a mere support role might imply, and how Rawlinson appeared not to consider their contribution whatsoever. Philpott also highlights a fundamental difference between the French and British artillery by suggesting the British did not use their artillery to conserve in the French way. It appears that the British Army still did not fully attribute part of their success to the more experienced French Army, nor had they a complete grasp on the effective use of their own artillery. However, there is little doubt that the results on the 14th of July had revealed to the BEF the key role that artillery held in modern warfare. The shorter length barrage and the switching of 0 hour to night time, 3:20 a.m. in this case, demonstrate an effective change in tact regarding tempo and timing. Looking at other elements of the day's fighting, 2nd Cavalry Division's inclusion in the 4th Army's order of battle indicates a marked development from the 1st of July, where Rawlinson's grandiose intentions for the cavalry of Gough's Reserve Army was a flight of fancy that sought to drive the Germans from the Arras salient should the opportunity arise. The 2nd Indian Cavalry Division's supporting attack on Highwood on the 14th of July gave the infantry protection on their flanks, and by the end of the day, the two cavalry regiments had only 8 killed and fewer than 100 wounded. By limiting its mission objectives, the cavalry was not only directly involved in the action this time around, but they also achieved very positive results. This tweaking of how branches of the army are used and the objectives of the fighting demonstrates an interesting coexistence of the concepts of operational art and operational science. Plans set down on paper using tried and tested methods are implemented successfully only by the creative initiative of their respective commanders. Over the period of the 15th of July to the 14th of September were, as described by Pryor and Wilson, the forgotten battles. These were comparatively small-scale affairs that sought to straighten the line in preparation for the next big offensive. Whilst the application of newly learned operational art may have led to certain local victories, the British Army commanders had evidently not developed any practices in an attempt to conserve men. Described by Simpkins as a serious erosion of the BEF's combat strength, Pryor and Wilson noted that during the 62-day period, the casualty rate was 40% higher than that of the 1st of July. In a letter addressed to the commanders of the 4th Army and Reserve Army on the 2nd of August, Haig saw it necessary to tell them to practice economy of men. During this time, however, the effectiveness of the British artillery continued to increase. Despite the heavy British losses, the Germans appeared to be faring even worse due to increasingly accurate and intense artillery, which usually helps to repel the many German counterattacks. And the systematic bombardment of their lines put the German troops under even greater psychological pressure than their British counterparts. Counter-battery effectiveness particularly increased over the course of 4.5 months. On July the 1st, many of the untouched German batteries proved incredibly troublesome, and it became incredibly clear that more counter-battery work was needed to be done if the Allies wanted to hold on to any territory gains. However, it is too easy to assume that the improvements made in this particular area of operational art fit as neatly into the adolescent to adult learning curve of the British Army during that period. Sanders Marble points out how the increase in importance of counter-battery work came mostly as a consequential reaction to the Germans relying more and more heavily on their artillery in defence once the British artillery had pulverised physical defences. Looking back to July the 1st, the counter-battery work had been haphazard and seemingly very much up to the individual prerogatives of the corps commanders. As Sanders Marble points out, on Z Day, 10th and 13th Corps had clever plans to fire on German howitzers, which were most dangerous to the infantry in the trenches, before 0 hour and neutralise field guns, the bigger threat to troops in the open, as the infantry advanced, while 7th Corps had exactly the opposite idea. Here we can see how operational art transcends the individual and that an almost faceless unity is needed in certain aspects of operational warfare, lest there be an imbalance of successes nearly as futile as failure in an entirety. During the 4.5 months, corps began to take on more control over their divisions and, in an example of an attempt towards this faceless unity, Sanders Marble points out how GHQ drafted, but apparently did not send, a memo warning divisions and corps to stop changing artillery orders and also granting higher echelons more control over operations. Once again, this demonstrates less so a direct change in operational art or the painting on the canvas, but rather a change to who is holding the paintbrush. The operational art of the individual can only go so far as the infrastructure will allow. Too many cooks spoil the broth, springs to mind. The fighting in September gave way to further breakthroughs, which saw the British Army practically through the really powerful German field fortifications. Although it was considered a limited victory on Haig's part, historians such as J.P. Harris, Paul Harris and Sanders Marble seem to agree that the step-by-step method proposed by Rawlinson may have proved to be more effective and less costly. Once again, we enter the great what-if of the Somme battle, and to follow on from our point made earlier about the unreliability of considering the bite-and-hold method on July the 1st to be one that could have worked, perhaps after the improvements made in operational artistry by September could certainly add credence to these historians' point of view. The introduction of the tank at the Battle of Fleurs-Courcelette on the 15th of September is an interesting case of demonstrating both the good and the bad of operational artistry. Despite its pitfalls, there is no doubt that the British Mark I tank was the result of creative ingenuity, especially when looking to the French and German counterparts and seeing how many more wrong decisions could have been made. But technological issues aside, from the perspective of operational art, the limited successes achieved by this promising machine was in large part due to the lack of operational unity and cooperation between the various arms. To look ahead to 1918, we see a war not won by any one arm or machine, but rather an interlaced force working and reacting in near, or at least attempted, unison. The tank did, however, demonstrate a concentrated effort to break the standardised artillery infantry cavalry format of attack. In September, artillery once again saw a development. Influenced by French doctrine, the September offensives involved a creeping barrage twice as dense and travelling slower than on the 1st of July. The resulting effect varied. On the 15th of September, fatal gaps were left between the creeping barrage to accommodate the tanks, whereas, by the action on the 21st of September, this problem had already been rectified. Philpott suggests evidence of improving tactical and operational methods by the end of September, but equally states that until the operational art improved and battle developed a faster tempo, more supple command methods and more flexible logistics, tactical triumphs would not be translated into strategic victory.
Had there been improvements in the British Army's operational art? Clearly there had. In September they were, however, still a long way from the Mona Lisa. Poor weather appeared to dictate events between the end of September and November. Coupled with Haig's unwavering determination to capture the German Transloy line, men were reportedly unable to keep up with their creeping barrage, as the quagmire of No Man's Land had them reduced to almost stationary targets. Once again, a higher concentration per yard of artillery pieces compared to the 1st of July aided greatly in the offensives. However, once the initial attacks lost momentum, the subsequent attacks became piecemeal, hastily organised affairs which lacked both weight and coordination, something which Simpkin suggests was frequently the case in 1916, and demonstrates how there was little effective development in that respect. The capture of Beaumont Hamel by November the 16th was more of a moral victory than one of strategy, and the fact that the German Munich-Frankfurt position on Redan Ridge wasn't captured until 1917 shows how limited their gains were. While comparisons can be made between the actions of the 1st of July at Beaumont Hamel and those in mid-November, one has to consider the drastic changes to the topography, the weather and troop manoeuvrability during that period. So much so, one would argue, that the question of improvement in operational art would not be linear, but rather a re-evaluation of the concept's four essential elements, according to the US military: time, space, means and purpose. What's more, by November, there were new individuals and units at play. Gough's 5th Army had replaced Rawlinson's 4th, and thus brought with him his own command culture, one of micromanagement, based on fear and uncertainty, according to Gary Sheffield and Helen McCartney.
There are some undeniable points of effective improvement of the British Army's operational art over the course of the Battle of the Somme. There is little doubt that the improved cooperation of the infantry and artillery played a major role in the British Army's successes, and that by November the barrages were heavier, more concentrated and more carefully targeted. Rawlinson's more realistic use of cavalry and the introduction of the tank show how the British Army command sought to effectively change traditional fighting formats in order to break the deadlock, and, eventually, act to conserve men, albeit with varied results. The battle also saw the development of the operational art of reconnaissance. Such a need required a strong flying corps, and thus the RFC underwent an effective change, which led to British aerial supremacy and more accurate bombardments. Training manuals were clearly affected by the Somme experience and complex French doctrine. In the SS-143 and SS-144, for example, the standard infantry platoon had been reorganised into specialist bombing, rifle, Lewis gun and rifle grenade sections. What saw less effective development was Haig's ability to receive counsel or criticism from his peers and subordinates. Whilst progression and improvements were evident in various areas, the ability to create an effective unity of forces of which later won the war was sliced at the Achilles in 1916 by the temperaments and indecision of high command individuals and the pressures to engage in the battle that Kitchener's army was just not ready for in July 1916. To look at the operational art of the individual by the end of the battle, it was as volatile and temporal as it was pre-July 1916. Most due to the fact British High Command was full of pre-war Edwardian and Victorian trained generals. To look at operational art as a collective product of the British Army, by November 1916 there is absolutely evidence to suggest improvements that would pave the way towards the war-winning British Army of 1918.